Like, I imagine, a lot of people, Zelda was one of my first experiences of really getting engrossed in a fantasy world in a game. Ocarina of Time rocked my world when I was about 7 or 8, and Majora's Mask was one of the first games I can remember being really excited for in the lead up to it coming out. I've kept that feeling of excitement through the game since. Wind Waker, Twilight Princess, Breath of the Wild, they've all given me new worlds to explore and play around in, and I've always loved it. The Zelda games aren't much like how we think of RPGs in a classical sense. No leveling up, no numerical stats for the most part, usually pretty fixed gear, minimal dialogue choices if any. But that feeling of immersion is something they're really good at. And I think we, as DMs, have a great deal to learn from them. One of the key selling points of almost every Zelda game, certainly the big tentpole ones, is the feeling of a whole world that's available for you to explore. In the earliest games, this extended to tackling the dungeons in any order. In other words, the whole world was open to you right from the off. Later games restrict this, usually for the sake of narrative. Certain areas often require specific items to access, and in some games, like Wind Waker, you're kept from going in certain directions until later in the game. But Wind Waker also has a great big open ocean, and eventually allows you to sail around on it at your leisure, with sunken treasure to find, lots of small islands with their own secrets, and occasional meetings with Beetle to light up your day.
Thank you!
Breath of the Wild goes even further by giving you the whole world as your playground, allowing you to climb up trees and cliffs wherever you see them, as well as running off in any direction, in classic open world style, and stumbling on something interesting. It's still an illusion, of course. The map does have limits. But what matters is how that illusion is disguised. Because you have so much freedom, what limits there are less obvious. Even way back in Ocarina of Time, seeing Death Mountain on the horizon prepared you for being able to climb it relatively early in the game. There's a sense there that the world is available to you. So the lesson here, I think, is that no matter what kind of game you're running, whether it's a pure sandbox or more based around a single central plot, it's good to make the world feel not only big, but accessible. Give your players information about other parts of the world, maybe in their backstory or throwaway NPC dialogue. Make it feel like, if they wanted to, the players could absolutely run off to another city on a whim or investigate that abandoned tower on the horizon. Of course, the trick is in guiding them so that they won't run off into areas you haven't designed or really thought about. That takes practice, and knowing your group really well. It's one of those instincts that you just have to develop as a DM. But I think it's to the benefit of any adventure to have that big world feeling. Even if your players never leave a single city, if they feel like there's a world outside of the walls that they could hop on a ship or a carriage anytime and see it, that'll really sell the setting to them at every level. I think one of the most important things to keep in mind when world building is that your world only really exists in the player's encounter with it. Whatever's in your head or your notes is useless unless it's translated to actual gameplay. In other words, extensive lists of city officials and historical personages should always be secondary considerations to the overall impression that your world or various bits of it give off. What do you want your players to think of this particular city or region? Friendly? Forbidding? Dangerous? Maybe all three, depending on what part you're in and who you are. The atmosphere of your setting and the tone of your game are inextricably linked. They feed into each other. And they are, together, the single thing that the players will remember most. Now, atmosphere and tone can be tricky things to really define, so let's look at some examples. Both Wind Waker and Breath of the Wild are set after some kind of Hyrule-destroying catastrophe, but they have very different tones. Wind Waker is a determinedly cheerful and playful game. Some of this comes from the visual style, of course, but it's also there in the story and characters. Think about Tetra's extremely unthreatening crew of pirates, for instance. Or the guy who runs the battleship game.
Hooray! Yay!
Or the fish who fills out your map. They're all quirky and weird and fun. And most importantly, memorable. Not incidentally, this is also one of the few games in which Link has a family as well as a home, which helps to ground the whole quest. After all, it starts with him just trying to rescue his kidnapped sister. A classic D&D character motivation, incidentally. Compare this with Breath of the Wild, where Link wakes up alone and doesn't meet any NPCs for probably a couple of hours of play, depending on your actions. It's a much more portentous game, suffused with melancholy, with Hyrule Castle surrounded by purple evil, often visible on the horizon as a constant reminder of what's happened and what's at stake. Half of the important characters are dead or trapped, and Link feels more alone in his quest to save the land than in most of the games. There's no King of Red Lions or Navi or Midna to keep him company, and even most of the NPCs who can be interacted with are pretty fleeting. It's not that Wind Waker doesn't have its darker moments, I always remember the frozen Hyrule Castle for instance, or Breath of the Wild doesn't have lighter ones, but what's important is the overall feeling that the game imparts. As a third example, consider my favourite game in the series, and one of my favourite games of all time, Majora's Mask. If Breath of the Wild is ominous and melancholy, Majora's Mask is Mozart's Requiem in game form. It's a game set on the brink of disaster, where everyone you meet is at most 72 hours from death, or, in quite a few cases, already dead. It's a game where Link literally wears the faces of dead people, going through what are implied to be horribly painful transformations, dozens if not hundreds of times in the course of the game, partly to gain the powers of those dead people, but also to fool their loved ones into thinking they're still alive. It's a game where NPCs can be found cowering in fear in the final hours, as a clock at the bottom of the screen counts down the minutes they have to live. Again, it's not without its moments of quirky humour, but it's undeniably a game about death on a fundamental level, and that permeates just about every aspect of the way you interact with the world and the people in it. And that, I think, is the key point when we're talking about atmosphere. It has to be holistic. It should be there in descriptions of places, in interactions with NPCs, NPCs' relationships with the PCs and with each other, everything. That might sound daunting, especially when a lot of this stuff is improvised at the table. But if you can come up with a broad, central idea, then it's just a matter of keeping that in mind and building everything around it as you go. There are lots of little tricks you can use as well, like playing music, something I'll talk about more in future videos. Just remember that your big ideas should be reflected at a smaller level as well. Which leads me on to a central tenet of the Zelda series, dungeons. Zelda dungeons are actually a pretty good, almost one-to-one comparison with D&D ones. After all, they're pretty much always, when you really break them down, a sequence of combat encounters and puzzles, culminating in a boss fight. In most games, they're even made up of a sequence of separate rooms that ends up looking very much like a D&D dungeon. Sometimes, especially in the older games, you even need to draw your own map, in classic D&D style. What's more, dungeons are fundamental to both Zelda and D&D. The latter is pretty obvious, it's one of the D's after all, even if the importance of dungeons has diminished since the 70s. But with Zelda, it's less immediately clear that this should be so. In general, like with a lot of RPGs, dungeons are how you progress the game, a bit like gyms in Pokemon games. They're like an obstacle standing in your way. The story reasons behind them are many. Kill a big monster that's affecting the land outside, retrieve a magical MacGuffin or person, free a trapped spirit, plus classics like cure a sick fish and help these yetis get into their bedroom. That in itself is something that we as DMs should think about. Why are the players venturing into this cave, tower, whatever? What is their motivation to go all actory on it? Without clear motivation, players get confused and lose interest, and that's how games flounder and peter out. so the purpose should be clear, and the dungeon design should reflect it. If there's a big boss to be fought, everything should feel like it's leading up to that boss, with maybe combat encounters containing reminders of the boss's presence. If there's someone to be rescued, maybe the characters can hear plaintive calls for help as they get closer to their target. Small touches like that can do an awful lot to help your players along and keep their interest and focus. And, if you want things interesting, variety of dungeons is key. Let's take Majora's Mask, which has four major dungeons, all referred to as temples. One in a poison swamp, one on a snowy mountain, one offshore, and one in a valley of the undead. Immediately, those are visually and conceptually very distinct, which makes them interesting. And they're clearly linked to the environment around them. They feel like they should be there, which is important. But that distinctiveness works on a more mechanical level too. They all feel quite different. Woodfall Temple has a lot of flying between different platforms. Snowhead Temple requires you to figure out how to drop its big central pillar in various places. Great Bay Temple is all about changing water flow. And Stone Tower Temple requires you to turn it upside down and back again to progress. That's not to say that every dungeon requires some kind of elaborate central gimmick, but it's worth thinking about as a way of making your dungeons memorable and exciting, as well as tying the design of the dungeon to its concept. Besides that, there's the classic Zelda tactic, where puzzles in most dungeons are solved primarily using the new item in that dungeon, so that the new item changes your experience of the dungeon significantly. So the Water Temple in Ocarina, where you get the long shot, has lots of hookshot targets just out of reach. Great Bay Temple, where you get ice arrows, has lots of things that need to be frozen to access new platforms or redirect the water flow. The Arbiter's Grounds dungeon in Twilight Princess has lots of walls that are crossed using that cool spinny thing whose name I've totally forgotten. You get the idea. That's not to say you should sprinkle very specific magic items through your dungeons to solve puzzles, but it's certainly not a bad idea to have a potential solution to a puzzle lying around. Say you need water to solve a puzzle, and there's an item that can create or destroy water a few rooms over. That's design that can help give the players options, which should be one of your central goals as a DM. Now, all of this is fairly ambitious advice, I know. There's nothing inherently wrong with a dungeon that's just a cave full of skeletons for your players to chop through. But the point is, that shouldn't be every dungeon. Give your players a variety of interesting places with fun challenges to explore, and they'll be talking about them for a long time. A couple of appendices to this section. While I was writing the script for this video, I came across this episode of the Eldritch Lore podcast, in which James Hake also talks about dungeon design inspired by Zelda. Do check that out if you're interested in this. They have some really interesting things to say about how Zelda dungeons fit their puzzles together, for instance, and how to present Zelda-style puzzles in a way that still gives your players room for choice and experimentation. And if you want a really deep dive into Zelda dungeons, their layouts, the key mechanics, and the design philosophy behind them, I very highly recommend Mark Brown's Boss Keys series. Not only is it a fascinating insight from a design point of view, he actually made me really like Ocarina's Water Temple, after more than two decades of hating it. What a champ! I've already mentioned puzzles and incorporating them into dungeons briefly, but I think there are some more lessons to be learned here. Now, I must admit, I'm not a huge fan of puzzles in D&D, as a general rule. For me, they often take the players out of their characters too much, being primarily challenges for the players rather than the characters. Which is fine for some games, but doesn't fit that well with mine. What's more, I struggle to figure out exactly why the evil wizard who built this dungeon is interested in whether wandering adventurers or thieves can figure out his riddles 3. Is he just a really gatekeeper-y Mensa type dude? I guess that wouldn't surprise me too much. But where I do use puzzles, I want them to solve both of these problems. To be tests for the characters as much as the players, and to have a clear purpose beyond just being a roadblock. And Zelda comes to the rescue here. Specifically, Breath of the Wild, with its spirit shrines, comes to the rescue. The spirit shrines are one of my favourite aspects of Breath of the Wild. While they are a bit aesthetically repetitive, the trials within are pretty much always fun, And like the best D&D puzzles, they reward creative thought and often have multiple potential solutions. All of that is great, but where things get interesting for my purposes here is that they also have a purpose within the world of the game. I referred to them a moment ago as trials, and that's exactly how they present themselves. They're testing Link to ensure he's up to the challenge before presenting him with a reward that will help towards his goal. That's a pretty classic piece of rationale for a puzzle, or even a whole dungeon, especially when the players are pointed that way by a friendly NPC, and it generally works just fine. You can also tailor puzzles to characters' abilities, just like the spirit shrines are often based around the specific functions of the Sheikah Slate. Maybe take a cheeky peek at your PC's spell lists and design with them in mind, although be sure you're designing them with all of your PCs in mind, not just one or two. You can also think about giving puzzles a purpose outside of just opening a door or stopping the spiky ceiling from descending. Going back to Zelda dungeons, they are often themselves intricate puzzle boxes whose structure needs to be figured out, where doing one puzzle or element of a puzzle changes the layout of the dungeon and allows you to proceed. There are any number of ways to accomplish this, depending on the dungeon, its setting, general terrain, even who lives there. And taking all of those things into account will, once again, make everything feel that bit more real, and help you with that all-important immersion. Time is a central mechanic in quite a lot of Zelda, whether in purely story terms, or as a central mechanic in the game as a whole, or even within specific dungeons. But I want to take particular inspiration, once again, from Majora's Mask. For anyone who doesn't know, Majora's Mask takes place over 3 days, the last 3 days before the moon falls and the world ends. Each time you get to the end of that time span, you have to do a share and turn back time to the beginning of the first day. This creates an obvious time pressure. You lose certain types of progress in questlines, and some of your possessions, whenever you reverse time. So dungeons usually have to be completed within 1 3-day span. You can slow down the flow of time, and you can skip forward to get to specific points, more on that in a bit. But there's no way to stop time. The clock is always at the bottom of the screen. And on the third day, the world rumbles every hour to signify the moon getting closer. It's a fun and interesting mechanic, because time pressure is a great way to focus your mind. There's all kinds of applications for this in D&D. Lots of DMs will apply some kind of time limit to a puzzle, sometimes pulling out an actual hourglass or similar timer as a physical manifestation of this. The same applies to someone taking absolutely ages to decide what they're doing in combat. After all, their character only has 6 seconds to choose and act, no matter how much of a tactical genius they are. Recently, my players came across a murder scene in broad daylight, and I told them they had 5 minutes in-world to investigate before the watch turned up and effectively barred them from the scene. I didn't bring out a real-world timer, but I advised them to be careful of what they chose to do, and every time they looked at some element of the scene or spoke to a witness, I told them how much time it was taking, how much time they had left. It ensured that they took very specific actions and followed very specific lines of reasoning, which itself ensured that they didn't get bogged down in unnecessary detail. If they had missed something important, I could have found a way to get that information to them later. But when your time is limited, what you do takes on enormous importance, and that's a really interesting position to be in as a player. As well as pressure, another important thing to consider is contingency. What happens when, and what might influence whether or not it happens then, or at all? Majora's Mask, again, does this really well. Certain events will always happen at certain times, and if you want to intervene in or see those events, you have to be there at that exact time. For instance, if you want to save the bomb shop lady from being mugged, you have to be in North Clocktown at midnight on the first day. This is interesting enough. But where it ramps up is that events influence each other from there on. If you do save the bomb shop lady, then the thief won't bring her wares to be sold at the curiosity shop on the second day, which means he won't be seen there, which means that a different questline can't continue beyond a certain point in that 3-day cycle. That's a pretty elementary DM lesson, that actions should have consequences, ripples, butterfly effect, that kind of thing. But again, I want to look at how time specifically plays into that. Chances are, in your setting or story, there are certain events external to the players that will happen at a set time, whether those be regular calendar events like festivals or even birthdays, or just something that is going to take place elsewhere in the world. And as a DM, you'll need to keep track of when these things will happen. Now, I think there is an argument to be made for shifting timelines around and being flexible with when certain festivals or other events fall, so as to accommodate your players. You don't want them to miss out on Fantasy Christmas because they took one long rest too many in that dungeon. But be careful of eroding the verisimilitude, the reality, so to speak, of your world. Time needs to pass, and things need to happen. Otherwise, it just feels like the world revolves around your players. And you can let them know X thing will happen in Y days. Maybe that important meeting of two ambassadors, or a ship coming in, or something like that. Especially if it's something their characters would know anyway. That gives them a mini calendar to keep track of. And players love keeping track of that stuff. Again, it helps them to get invested in the world. And it gives a little pressure. And again, a little pressure is a very good thing in terms of investment. Even if the moon isn't falling, a ticking clock of any kind is a good tool for building tension. And it helps you and your players to think about how time works in your world, which is almost certainly very different to how time works in the real modern world, where we're always available and we count time in terms of minutes more so than days. Which is yet another way of making your world feel real and distinct from the world we usually live in. Controlling time is one of your most important and powerful tools as a DM, and using it wisely, like Link, can really improve your player's experience at the table. By the nature of this topic, and by virtue of how many Zelda games there are, I'm really just skimming stones over the surface of a very deep lake here. I'd be very interested to know any other lessons you've learned or think could be learned from either the series as a whole or individual games. And I look forward to playing Breath of the Wild 2 with a DM's eye, carefully searching for ideas to nick from my D&D game. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to leave a like if you've enjoyed this and found it interesting, and do subscribe for more videos like this one in the future. Until then, goodbye, friends.